Good morning. So I was honored to baptize 21 folks yesterday with Pastor Timothy Gaines. The park ranger got there a little bit late. He picked up our street sandwich board signs and he brought them over to our camp and he said, "You guys can't do this here." He said, "I did you a favor by picking up your signs for you," right? I said, "Thank you, brother," right? Somebody in our camp overheard him telling people earlier that he was going to shut us down, right? And we were already out in the water, right? You have to send the FBI out here into the water to handcuff me to get us to stop this now, amen? Like to see the cops walk out there in the water. "You're under arrest, Pastor Ronnie. Let me baptize you first, police officer." If you have your Bibles, you can turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 14. My favorite gospel, the book of John. John the Revelator. John the one that Jesus loved. Jesus didn't say that. John himself said that. Mom loves me more. John chapter 14, verse 1 through 7. If you're there, say, "I got it." "Let not your heart be troubled." Got it? I love how you guys just like scream out. This is a Pentecostal church. Do your thing. Keep your loincloth on. "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." Jesus said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas the doubter said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way?" Jesus said, "I am the way. Amen. If you had known me, Jesus, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him," right? I can only imagine what it might be like. Amen. Oh, yeah, I forgot to do that, right? Somebody came up to me yesterday and said, "Hey, what decade should I be studying for tomorrow's title?" I said, "It's an easy one." I wanted to call it Stairway to Heaven, but I gotta save that for a different day. How it must grieve our Heavenly Father, right? The Lord has gone to prepare a place for us, yet we don't fully comprehend that, right? How it must grieve him that so few of his children want to go home. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about heaven today, if you don't mind. Here we are in enemy territory amid the sufferings of the present time, the darkness, the evil, troubled by sin, seeing our Father's name disrespected, dishonored, trashed all around us, and yet we want to stay here. We not fully understand what Jesus said when he said, "I go to prepare a place for you." That's one of the things about heaven. You have to act now. You can't take any chances. You can't risk it. You have to decide now if you're in or you're out, right? Because the Bible says that no one knows the day or the hour. So you have to be ready. And I think in the modern age, we've gotten away from what the Jesus Revolution was teaching, which is, do you know where you're going to go when you die, right? Do you want to go to heaven when you die, right? That was the big thing in the 70s, right, and into the early 80s. We went down to the beach and we saw the Jesus freaks, right? The Bible thumpers. And they would say, "Repent, for the kingdom is at hand." And we go, "Dude, you're hurting my buzz, bro. You're weird, dude." Here it is 40 years later, and we're doing the same thing. Amen. So Matthew 24, verse 36 says, "No one knows the day or the hour when these things will happen, not even the angels in heaven or the Son himself. Only the Father knows." This is symbolic of the old Hebrew wedding ceremony, right? Only the Father knows when he will send his Son for his bride, right? So only God knows when he's going to tell Jesus, "Son, it's time to go get your bride." Jesus himself doesn't even know it until the Father tells him. Thus, we must be ready, right? I wrote my paper, my term paper on the book of Revelation in Bible college on the three rapture theories at the time. There's a pre-tribulation rapture theory, a mid-trib, and a post-trib. And I wrote my paper on that. And at the end of every paper, term paper at Bible college, you had to give your own personal sort of spin on it or your own opinion, right? So what I did is I equated the rapture theory, because no one knows the day or the hour for a reason, right? Do you think that God would be dumb enough to tell us all the day and the hour that he's going to come back? And would we not just live it up until then, right? Did you not know that we were born into sin, right? And we battle this flesh every single day? So I equated it to this. When I was 16 years old, I lived alone with my father. It was just me and my dad, right? And he comes home one day and he tells me, "I'm going back east to visit family. I'll be gone for 3 weeks. I'm like, "Yes, I'll miss you, Dad. Be safe." He said one thing: keep the house clean. No parties, and you better keep this house clean, right? And I'm thinking, no way is that happening. I was a junior in high school, right? We partied every single day for 3 weeks. I had these ragers. I had hundreds of kids in my house. I didn't even know where they came from. They didn't even go to our school. My house was totally trashed, right? Because I knew exactly what day he was coming home, right? I knew when his flight was. I knew how long it took him to drive from the airport. So the morning of the day that he was coming home, we cleaned up the house. All my friends, and we were frantic. We were actually putting things away and cleaning things up. We had a window on our front door. I could see my dad drive up into the driveway and walking up, and I was freaking out, man. So all my friends are jumping over the back fence in my backyard while my dad is walking in, right? And so he comes in, of course, and he goes through the whole house. And he looks at everything, right? And I'm thinking, oh, he's going to know. He has to know. He has to know, right? He looks at me and goes, "Good job, son. I'm proud of you," right? And I think that very story might have gotten me an A on that paper at school, right? And so that's my point, right? If we know the day or the hour, we are going to just live it up. And then we're going to say things like, "Well, I'll repent when that time comes," or "I'll get cleaned up when that time comes. Jesus is coming at this time," right? He gave us the signs of the end times, and he gave us signs for his return so that we would get ready, not party up until that day, right? These are just warning signs because he loves us. We have a God that loves us so much that he's letting us know, look, when you see the signs of the end times, right, look up, for your redemption is near, and I'm on my way. Keep preaching. Keep preaching the word, right? The Apostle Paul said, "I long to be with you, Lord, in heaven," which is far better, right? He said, but if you tarry, if you decide to wait, then it's far better for the unbelieving world that I stay, because I have an opportunity to continue to preach the gospel, right? So every day that you don't return, Lord, I still do the work of the kingdom. I don't stop living. I don't stop spreading the gospel. I don't stop speaking the good news until I see you, like the Bible says, returning in the clouds the way you left, right? Amen? Are you with me, church? Do I wish that I had more time? I can get selfish because I have kids. I have kids that aren't going to heaven if the Lord returns today. I say this all the time in a selfish way. And while I was writing this message today, I was thinking to myself, how selfish is it of me to say that if the Lord returned today and he said, hey, Ronnie, what do you think about me ending this all right now? And I always like to say in my arrogance, I would tell Jesus, can I have a little bit more time, Lord, right? Not for me, God. Like the Apostle Paul said, I'm ready. It's far better for me. I'm ready myself to go to heaven. But if you could just give me a week to convince my two sons that this is it, I would appreciate it, right? But how long can we do that? How long can we push that out? How long can we say that we need more time? The Lord says, I'm long-suffering, right? I wish that no one would perish, and I have given you ample, plenty amount of time, but there's going to come a day. There will be a day, amen, where he's going to return, and we need to rejoice, and we need to look forward to that. In fact, we need to get out of here. Right? Because I just saw the Sound of Freedom last Tuesday night. And I say, Lord, come quickly. Amen. I say, Lord, how much longer do we do this? How much longer do we suffer and live in pain and have to witness what's happening to our children? Lord, you said you would not give us more than we can take. We're at the end of our rope. God, end it now. Yes. Amen? What else do we have other than the hope of heaven? The hope of heaven is there to end the darkness, to end the sin, to end the debauchery, to end the abuse, right? Yes. Now I'm watching the movie, and I shared this with some of the folks on Bible study Thursday night. If you saw the movie, raise your hand. So, Jim Caviezel, God bless that brother for what he's done, man. Two movies, right? The last time I was hit that hard by a movie, it was when he played Jesus in Passion of the Christ, right? And so Jim's character, I can't remember the actual guy's name.
Tim Ballard,
okay. So this guy walks into his boss's office and he tells him, he says, hey, I'm broken, brother. I've seen things that no one should see, and I want to do something about it. I got to put the pieces of myself back together. I need to go to Colombia, and I need to rescue a girl, right? I need to rescue, where was she from?
Honduras.
I need to rescue a Honduran girl from Colombia. And his boss said, America's not in the business of rescuing Honduran children from Colombia. And I thought to myself, the biggest, baddest, most powerful country on the planet isn't in the business of saving kids? Who else is going to do it, right? We have the power and the resources to do it, but we're not in the business? Then what? If we're not in the business of saving children, right, we like to boast in our arrogance of how we police the world, and we step in when wars and conflicts are going bad, and we step in and we save the little guy, right? But we won't save the kids, 2 million kids a year being trafficked in the sex industry, and we won't step in. If we don't step in, Lord Jesus, come quickly and end this. Is this our only option? Let's just get this over with. Amen? Because I don't know about you, but I'm at the end. I don't want to see this anymore. I don't want to watch our children being abused like this anymore. And it is the most helpless feeling. I held it together throughout the movie as best I could, but when I got out, I looked at my wife's face, and I just lost it. And I just bawled like a baby. And I get it, Mom, I'm getting emotional just now thinking about it, because what can we do? What can we do? Here's one thing we can do because of the dark, ugly world that we live in today. Don't ever let your kids out of your sight. Never. Never. Never let your children out of your sight. No more sleepovers with people that they don't know or you barely know, right? Because she seems like a great mom from school, right? No more of that. No more of taking your eyes off your... When I was a kid, we ran wild, right? We never knew where we were. And when we needed to drink water, we drank it out of a garden hose from some stranger's house. You just walk right up their driveway, turn the hose on, and drink some water. Hey, thanks. Come home before the street lights are on. But those days are over. You got kids and you got grandchildren. They're looking for them. You take your eyes off of them for 1 second and they could be gone. Because this is big business. Child trafficking is the second biggest business in the world next to drugs. That's where we live. That's where we're at, right? Lord, come quickly. We should always have our eyes on heaven. It is about heaven. It's about heaven. It's always been about heaven. God gave us the warning signs leading up to his return because he's going to come and get us and take us where? To heaven. It's about heaven. Without heaven, this is all a joke. Without heaven, Jesus Christ is David Koresh, right? Without heaven, he was just a false prophet. It's all about heaven. Why did he come? He came to abolish sin and death and conquer death on the cross. Why? So we could go to heaven. Have we forgotten about heaven? Luke 21:28. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up. Your redemption draws nigh. The goal is and has always been heaven. Philippians 3:14 says, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. What's the prize? Nope. The goal is heaven. Believe it or not, what this verse means is the goal is heaven. The prize is your calling. The prize is that you've been selected out of the world to spread the gospel. That's your calling. That's your prize. Believe it or not, the prize that you've been giving is the opportunity to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and then in turn, spread the news. Amen? And then the goal is heaven. Right? Amen. Philippians 1:23-24. For I am hard-pressed, this is what Paul said, between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. That's spreading the gospel right there. If it was just all about me, I didn't care about my kids. I don't care about you guys. I don't care about the unbelieving world. I don't care. I just want to go to heaven because I don't care. It's just about me, right? I would rather be in heaven, obviously. But since you've tarried, Lord, I continue to spread the word, right? And this is why it's so important. Because sometimes all we want to do is give up. You want to give up on your 40-year-old son who you've been preaching to, and he never receives it, and he wants to argue with you about it all the time. And I think to myself, when I look at his beautiful, precious face, and I think to myself, how could I ever live without this boy? Right? And so I still lean in every chance I get. Every chance I get. I talk to him about the Lord. I get little cracks in there. And I'll just throw a little sentence out there to see how he receives it, right? And as he's gotten older, he receives it a little bit more and a little bit more. He watches what's going on in this church. He watches what I'm doing online. He corrects me all the time on Facebook. Dad, you can't say that. Dad, what are you posting those pictures from? Like, talk to your mother. Right? I'm not doing it. But my point is, right, I can't stop. I can't give up. Until the day I die or the Lord brings me home, I have to tell him. I have to warn him because I don't want to be without him, right? But there's going to come a day where it's going to be between him. It's going to be between him and the Lord. And I'm not going to have anything to do with it anymore. I can't force him into heaven, although I'd like to. I like to put him over my knee. I never spanked my kids. You know why? Because my parents were hitters. Raise your hand if you got hit by your parents, man. Look at, oh my goodness. My parents would, man, that was the first thing they did is whack you, right? And then they ask questions. What? Whack. What happened now? Whack. Right? My mom would get mad at me. She'd banish me to my room in the summertime at 9 o'clock in the morning, right? She'd go, get in your room. You're grounded for the day. 9 hours later, my dad comes home, and he comes in. He just starts wailing on me, right? I'm like, Dad, why are you hitting me? He's like, I don't know. Your mom told me to come in here and spank you. I'm like, so you don't even know why you're hitting me? No. Your mom told me to hit you, so I am. I'm like, Dad, what did I do? I don't even remember what I did. And my mom goes, remember this morning? So that traumatized me so bad, I never touched my children. I screamed at them. Yeah. And they used to tell me, Dad, you didn't need to hit us. Your yelling and your screaming put the fear of God into us. So, well, okay, it worked in some weird way. So never forget that reason Jesus came here. It's heaven. The book of Revelation says this. Chapter 4, verse 1 through 3. After these things, after what things? After Jesus had talked to John and gave him a vision to encourage, to exhort, right? The churches. To give them some direction. And some correction, right? The seven churches. After these things, I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here. And I will show you things which must take place after this. Well, this can be a picture of the rapture, right? But I believe it's also symbolic that the Apostle John was given a glimpse of what heaven would be like so that he could write it down, right, and share it with us all these years later. This is how much God loves us. You want to know why you're struggling? You want to know why you're walking and living in darkness? You want to know why there's so much? This is the reward, right? God loves us so much that he gave us signs to the times that he's going to return, and this is where you're going, right? You all know I'm going to have a mansion in heaven. You all know that, right? And how do I know that? Because he said so. He said, come up here. When you're having a bad day, when you're going through a difficult period in your time, remember to look up. Remember, come up here and take a look and stay focused on this. This is your home. This is where you'll spend eternity. This is where there'll be no more tears, no more sin, no more evil, no more child abuse, right? When you're having a tough time, look up and don't forget that the promise is heaven. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
He said, immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardius stone, white and red in appearance, and there was a rainbow around the throne. In appearance like emerald. Jesus, God, gave Noah the rainbow as a Noahic covenant to let us know that he would never flood the earth and wipe out mankind again. Don't ever forget where the rainbow came from. Amen? Jesus said, come up here so I can give you a glimpse of what life with me in this place called heaven is going to be like, right? The apostle John was banished to the island of Patmos at this time. Banished. And here's why he was banished. The Roman Empire, Domitian, commanded that the apostle John be boiled to death in a pot of oil. Can you imagine? Hopefully it was olive oil. You know, because, you know, all of, you don't get a bunch of wrinkles if you... You got to be married to an Italian to get that. Because he wouldn't stop preaching the gospel, right? The emperor Domitian said, I'm going to boil you in a pot of oil because you won't shut up. And I'm sick and tired of listening to this Jesus thing, right? I'm sick of it. I was at the gym the other day and I was working out. And this kid comes up and he gets on the machine behind me. And I'm with a friend of Aaron. Are you here, Aaron? I'm with Aaron and he's working out with me. And Lisa's there with me. And this kid sits down in the machine next to us. And all I see on his shirt is Jesus. And so I'm like, oh, I go, hey, man, what's that say on your shirt? And then he goes like this and it says, not today, Jesus. Right? And I'm like, I just turned around and walked away, right? But I was like, inside, I was so hurt. Like, you put that on your t-shirt, man? It's one thing to say it or to think it, right? And you stole it from us because we say, not today, Satan. So come up with your own stuff, man, right? Get creative. Don't steal it from us. The saying is, not today, Satan, right? And he thought he was so cool, not today, Jesus. And I turned around and I walked back to Aaron. And I said, Lisa, and I said, that kid's lucky I'm the pastor of this church. Otherwise, we might have something to say, right? It's none of my business, though. Where was I? Oh, so he wouldn't shut up. The Apostle Paul would not shut up, so Domitian tried to kill him. He tried to silence him. Because, believe it or not, he continued to preach from within the pot of oil. Right? You can do whatever you want to me. You're not going to shut me up. This is the thing about being evangelists and spreaders of the gospel. Nothing can shut you up, right? And if they take your body, they can't take your soul. Fear the one that can take your body and your soul to hell, right? Amen? They can only take your body, but not your soul. So if they put you in a boiling pot of oil, keep yapping, right? I'm at the point in my life where you can't silence me. You can't silence me, right? I'll fight you over this. I'll debate you till the cows come home over what's in this book, right? Don't get political, Pastor. Don't take sides, Pastor. Don't do this. I take this side. I take the side that Jesus took. And when something in this life and something in this world and something in this culture goes against what's in this book, right? I have come to my age of wisdom where I get to say whatever I want because I'm old, right? And so now I do. And I make sure I try my best to back it up with what's in here, right? I don't care who you voted for. I don't care what your sexual orientation is. I don't care what your views are on different things, right? But if it goes against the Word of God, believe me, I'm going to speak out against it. Amen? In love, right? Don't forget. The Bible says to speak out and speak the truth, but everything you do, do in love, right? I tell my son, I'm going to hit you in love if you don't change your ways. I have my son on my mind because he lives in Atlanta and he's going to be here next week. So. My baby. So since Domitian couldn't kill him, he exiled John to the island of Patmos. And John was the only person on the small island. So I can't kill him. His God is keeping him alive for some reason. So I'm just going to get him out of here. I'm just going to get him out of the community, away from earshot, and just put him on a deserted island by himself and just let him die of old age out there. Which, by the way, John, the Apostle John, the Revelator, is the only apostle who didn't die a violent death. He actually did live a full life and died a peaceful death. Since we can't kill him, we'll silence him, right? But this is exactly where God wanted him. Alone and away from everyone. Away from the chaos. Just him and God alone on a deserted island. Sometimes when you feel like you're being boiled in a pot of oil, and then you're all alone, and there's nobody there for you, that's right where God wants you. Right? You're going through a difficult time, and you're grieving, and you're in pain, and you're hurting, and you're experiencing loss, right? And you feel like no one's there for you. No one cares. No one's visiting me in the hospital. No one's giving me a call or a text. No one cares about me. And then God says, this is right where I want you. And in a cave on this island is where Jesus spoke to John and gave him the vision for the book of Revelation. Amen? Amen? The book that would become the driving force for evangelism to this day was given to John on the island of Patmos in a cave while he was all alone. And you know he had to be in fear. He wrote of Christ's second coming. He wrote about the signs of the end times. He wrote about the seven-year tribulation that's coming upon us. And he warned us that we need to be right with God before the rapture of the church. Amen? Amen. And he wrote about heaven. Jesus said to him, come up here and I will show you things which must take place after this. We need to never forget that it's all about heaven. Heaven is the ultimate reason he came. The greatest miracle, I just said, was abolishing sin on the cross so we could go to heaven. And I'm talking to you, church. I'm talking to the precious, beautiful, loving people of God. You've been strained. You've been stretched beyond your limits emotionally. You've suffered physical pain and hurt. You've suffered financial difficulty. You've struggled with addiction, anxiety, impurity, depression, loneliness, and darkness. And the pressures of life can make you forget that there's a better life waiting for you on the other side in a place called heaven. Amen? That's your hope. Amen. When all else fails, that's your hope. If nothing else ever works out in your life, that's your hope. You hold on to heaven. We're all going to heaven someday. I'm going. I mean, raise your hand if you think you're not going to heaven. Right? That's right. We're all going. Because we've been given that promise. And that's where we're going to spend eternity with Jesus and Billy Graham. And Jensen Franklin. Satan wants to keep your attention on your problems. Right? And off of your promises. Focus on your problems. Forget about the promises that God has given you. He wants you to live a hopeless, shallow, meaningless, earthbound life. The enemy wants you to feel weak and tired and exhausted and depressed and discouraged. If he can get you so focused on his promises rather than God's promises, then he wins. We can get so caught up in the stresses of everyday life that we start questioning God. And we start questioning God's existence. And we start questioning whether God actually even knows that we exist. And then what happens? Heaven's taken off the table. Because now we're questioning God's existence, so heaven's not an option anymore, right? Because now we're guilty of sin, right? By not believing, right? What's the one of the unforgivable sins? Blaspheming the Holy Spirit and not believing in Jesus, right? So now heaven's off the table because the enemy has you so focused on your earthbound life, right? That you start questioning God, and that's what Satan wants you to do. Satan's promise is this. He wants to kill you. He wants to kill you and destroy your family. What a great promise. Not today, Jesus, right? I see banners. Satan loves you. Are you joking? Satan loves you? You are exalting the name of Satan, who was a created being that God kicked out of heaven, right? And you're acknowledging his power over the power of Jesus Christ, right? Jesus loves you, and Satan wants to kill you. You Satanists, read the Bible. God's promise is that he so loved the world that he sent his only son, and that whoever believes in him shall have life, and life more abundantly. Right? Life, and life more abundantly. Amen. Peace and happiness, right? On this earth, provision and love on this earth, and then more abundantly in heaven. Amen? Are you having a bad day? Are you having a bad week? Are you going through a difficult time? Come up here. Come up here. Take a look. Take a look at what I have you when this is all over. See from heaven's perspective what's really going on when you're struggling down there. Heaven is a real place. It's not just a state of mind. We make movies about it, right? And everybody gets to go. Everybody ain't going. Sorry. I didn't make the rules. Some people ain't going. It's not just a sentimental dream. It's not just some imaginary place that we've made up to comfort people who are grieving the loss of a loved one. This is some sort of protection we have to protect our hearts from hurt and pain when people die that we love, right? And we can go to the funeral of the most wretched, evil human being who's ever walked the earth, and we'll say, well, at least he's in a better place, right? No, he ain't. Did you witness the same life that I did that this guy lived? Why do we do that? Right? Because we want to protect and we want to comfort the family members. And we go, yeah, that guy that was married 8 times, spent most of his life in prison, ripped off everybody in his family. He was the most wretched person we've ever, but he's dead? Oh, well, he's in a better place. He might be, but he might not be. And regardless of where he goes, you right? When you guys take the mic at my funeral, speak the truth, right? I want to hear, don't gloss it over. He was a pain in the butt. He was hard to be married to. I spent 35 years married to him. He was difficult to live with. He was a whining, crying, arrogant little musician, right? Who thought the world revolved around him. But he has some good parts to him. Say that. Because that's really all of us. Yeah, sometimes, man, I just wanted to whack the dude. But sometimes I just loved him. Isn't that all of us? Why can't we just be honest, right? If heaven isn't real, then the Bible is a lie. Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, because I'm incapable of lying, because I am God and I cannot lie, if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare. I'm here for this. I'm here for that. Right? I came here to tell you that I'm going to forgive you of your sins. I'm going to be the sacrificial lamb to stamp out the temple sacrifices and everything else that you guys are doing. So all you have to do is pray to me for forgiveness of sin. And when I establish that on this earth, I'm leaving and I'm going to prepare a place for you. Again, symbolic of the old Hebrew wedding, right? When that engagement, that betrothal took place, right? The first thing he did was go home and him and his dad would build an addition to the house that they already lived in for him and his wife. Now, the only drawback to that is you had to live with your in-laws for the rest of their lives. I guess that's why we all have separate houses now. I don't know. I've lived with my in-laws. And it was glorious, hon, remember? Yeah, I almost got myself in trouble there. Man. Acts chapter 1, verse 11. Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? The angel said, this same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven. He's going to return. Said he would. The Bible said he's going to return, and we need to be ready. The promise has always been everlasting life with God in heaven. That's the promise. So when life gets difficult here, hold on to heaven. We should write a song called Hold On to Heaven, right? I get all the royalties. You can play bass. Yeah. 1 Thessalonians 4:16, 18. Huge, right? For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Amen. Therefore, right? Hold on. There's more. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Comfort. Are you going through a difficult time? Are you struggling with something? Are you addicted to something you just don't want in your life anymore and you can't put it behind you? Know that Jesus is going to return and he's going to relieve all your pain and all your stress and all your anxiety. And that's coming from me who's been through it all, right? And Jesus has delivered me from all of that. And so I, from me to you, I say, take comfort in this because the Lord's going to return. And if you look, it's getting closer and closer and closer all the time, right? We're ready, Lord. We're ready. Come and get us. If you got babies, don't worry about it, right? The age of maturity is 12 or 13 years old. All kids go to heaven. All dogs go to heaven. Yep, you better believe it. All 9 of my cats are going to heaven too. Every single one of them. Yeah. You guys are funny. And we've been commanded to preach about heaven. We've been commanded to preach about heaven and to preach about the second coming of Christ. That's why we're here. That's our purpose in life. Our purpose in life is to preach about the return of Jesus because I love you, and my purpose in this life is to serve God's people, right? People, what is my purpose in life? Why am I here, right? Jesus said that your purpose in life is to serve my people, right? Not yourself, God's people. Yes, amen. And everybody is God's people, right? I saw this thing. Somebody sent me this thing on a text the other day. And this guy comes walking up in the middle of the service to this pastor, and he says, hey, I want to say a prayer, right? And the pastor got irate. He said, get this bozo out of here, right? And so all the elders of the church came up and grabbed the guy. And so he turned to the congregation and he said, if you're not a Baptist, get out! And I thought, are you serious, dude? If you're not a Baptist, get out? I thought that was funny. One person laughed. He said, I command you to comfort one another with these words. I'm here this morning to comfort you. I have come to tell you that heaven, don't forget, is a real place. The great C.S. Lewis said that the Christians who did the most for the present world were the ones who thought the most of the next world. When Christians cease to think of the other world, they become ineffective in this one. What does that tell you? If we're not looking to heaven, we're missing the point. We might as well just give up now. We can't do anything about our kids. We can't do anything about the craziness that goes on in our country, right? Heaven is mentioned 1,865 times in the Old Testament. Get this, 316 times in the New Testament. You think that was an accident? If it's mentioned that much, we should be taking heaven seriously. We should be talking about it. We should be singing about heaven. We should be preaching about heaven. We should be shouting about heaven. We ought to be testifying about heaven. Let's not get so caught up in our lives on this earth. Pastor Timothy calls it earth dwellers, right? Isn't that? You're an earth dweller. You love your life on earth more than you do heaven. Let's not forget that heaven is our permanent home. And when life gets difficult, we look up. When life gets you down, look up. When you feel like all hope is lost, look up. Your redemption is near. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we will be transformed and changed at the sound of the last trumpet. This mortal will put on immortality, and this corruption will put on incorruption, and we will be like Jesus. The Bible says in 1 John 3:2, but we know that he appears. When he appears, we shall be like him. We shall see him. For we shall see him as he is, and every man that has this hope, Jesus is our blessed hope, purifies himself for what? The coming return of God, so we can go to heaven, because if you ain't purified, you ain't going. Yeah. Right? What did we talk about last week? One container to the next. Get yourself out of the container of impurity and get yourself away from all the dregs and get into the container of purity. Right? And then get on the bus. We're all going. We should all get on the same bus, right? He's coming back, and here's the thing. His reward is coming with him. Yes. And what we're doing here on earth is not in vain. Do you know why we have a generation who doesn't think that purity matters and holiness matters and standards matter and moral code matters and convictions matter? Do you know why? Because they don't believe Jesus is coming back at any moment. And they're not convinced that heaven is greater than this world. If heaven isn't greater than this world, what's the point? We might as well just live the way we want. Live for ourselves. How do you validate your life? I got 5,000 friends on Facebook. I got 7,500 likes on my profile picture. I'm popular, man. I bet. I bet you're popular. I'm popular too. Not in a good way, right? Somebody said to me yesterday, they asked me about Facebook, and I said, yeah, I read the good comments. And they said to their friend next to them, he reads the good comments. If you send him a message on Facebook, he reads the good ones, right? And I said, yeah, because my wife lets me read the good ones. And she keeps the bad ones from me, right? So as far as I'm concerned, everybody loves me on Facebook, right? But I'm not that dumb. I know she hides stuff from me. It's okay. 2,163 times the Bible talks about Christ coming to get us and rescue us from this dark and evil world. Revelation 13:6 says that Satan opened his mouth to blaspheme God in three things: to slander God, to slander his name, and to slander his dwelling place, God's person, God's people, and God's place. Satan hates heaven. And if he can get you to believe that it doesn't exist or that it's no better than what you're living in now, he wins and you lose. After forcibly being evicted from heaven, according to Isaiah 14, he is bitter towards God, bitter towards God's people, and bitter towards God's home, a place called heaven, right? God doesn't exist. God doesn't love you. And heaven isn't real. Aren't you glad we already know who wins the battle? And here's the thing. People ask me all the time, well, why is there a war? Why the battle? Doesn't Satan know he's going to lose? Yeah, he does. You ever been in a losing battle? I'm taking as many people as I can with me, right? Well, if I'm going down, all you all are going down with me. And that's where we're at. He knows he loses. What nobody knows yet is how many people are going with him. And here it is. Everybody just close your eyes for a second. Everybody in this room. And envision this. The most beautiful place you've ever been. Complete with palm trees, raging rivers, jagged, beautiful mountains, waterfalls, snowdrifts, the most gorgeous thing you've ever seen. Now think of your friends and your family members who love Jesus. They're running to you with open arms. Picture them as you're walking together in this beautiful, beautiful, glorious place. Because not only is heaven going to be beautiful, right? All of our loved ones who believe in Jesus Christ that have died, we will get to see them again. That's worth it for me. I live in a van down by the river to see my loved ones again. Amen? And Revelation 21 tells us what will not be in heaven. Right? No more death. No more addiction. No suicide. No more violence. No more prejudice. No more injustice. No more gossip. Can you believe that? Ooh. You just ruined my lunch, Pastor. No more gossip. Come on. If you're gossiping, knock it off. I'll send you to your room. No worry, no anxiety, no depression, no murder, no more child abuse, amen. Amen. No more tears, no more trials, trauma, temptations. There'll be no sin, no suffering, no separation, no starvation, no more hurt, no more pain, no more sorrow, no more sickness, no more tears. God promises to wipe away every tear from our eye. Amen. Hallelujah. There's no greater question to answer than this. Where will you spend eternity? Come up here, Jesus said. Come. Come just as you are. He'll save you. He'll cleanse you. Through the blood of the cross, he will raise you from death to life, right? I can only imagine what it's going to be like. Right? Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Amen. God bless you guys. Let's stand. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord.